The resurrection of Jesus Christ is the event that has had the greatest impact on your life. Because Jesus rose from the dead, you know he's God, so your faith in him is not in vain. You know your sins are forgiven because the resurrection proves the Father accepted his payment for your sins at the cross. So you don't have to live with this dark cloud of gloom hanging over your heads. You know you're going to conquer death yourself and live in heaven because he promised, because I live, you also will live. And you don't have to live your life in a mad scramble for ultimate fulfillment here on earth while you hear the clock ticking down in the background as death gets closer, because you're going to live forever. Well, at least that's what the Bible says about the blessings of his resurrection for you. What if the Bible's not true? Well, the reassuring message from God today is that the Bible is true. What it says about Jesus' resurrection and your blessings are true. So be certain that the blessings of the resurrection are yours, because God's word is certain. And let's begin with rejoicing in just that fact. The call to worship and invocation is at the top of page 2. People of God, Christ.
Dishonoring you and hurting.
By the authority and command of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Yes. Is he going to work out everything for your good? Yes. You know that because you know everything the Bible has said about him is true and God's word is
true.
Let's say a little prayer right now, thanking God for his true word. Dear Jesus, you rose from the dead so your disciples would know you really are God and the Savior. And then you showed them from the Bible that you've said that all along, that the Savior would come and suffer and die and rise again. Help us to know that every single day, between now and when we die, you will keep your promises to us. For your word is true, and one day you'll take us to be with you in heaven. Amen. You can go back to your seats. Thank you. Our first lesson for today is our gospel lesson. And I know that's not the usual order. Usually the gospel lesson is the third lesson. We've switched it up a little bit today because what we want to establish is that Jesus came to his disciples on Easter Sunday evening, assured them he was risen, showed them the word of God, how everything that had happened to him was foretold. And the difference that made, as we will see for both Peter and John in the subsequent readings. So we're going to start with our gospel lesson from Luke chapter 24, verses 36 through 49. We find the disciples on Easter Sunday evening described by these words, terrified, frightened, and troubled. And maybe those are words that describe you when you're facing despair in your life, or guilt, or uncertainty, or fear like they were. But the risen Savior dispelled that fear and uncertainty and despair with peace and confidence and joy, not only by appearing to them, but by showing them from the scriptures that this was God's plan all along. It's the scriptures that would continue to provide them with peace and joy and confidence as they did the work he assigned them of spreading the gospel to all people. And in the word of God, we'll find the same peace, confidence, and purpose. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." But they were terrified and frightened and thought they were looking at a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? Why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. Because a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While they still did not believe him because of their joy, and while they were still wondering, he said to them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish and some honeycomb. He took it and ate it in front of them. He said to them, "These are my words which I spoke to you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. He said to them, "This is what is written, and so it must be. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. Look, I am sending you what my Father promised. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." This is our gospel lesson. Our second lesson is from Acts chapter 12, verses 1 through 19. Certainty and peace from God's word is real, and we see that in Peter. It's now about maybe 10 to 12 years after Jesus' resurrection and ascension. Jesus hasn't been around for a while, but Peter still has his word. He still has Jesus' promise to live always to the end of the world. He has his mission from Jesus to preach the gospel. He has the promise from Jesus that when he dies, Jesus is going to take him to heaven. And that's why, arrested by King Herod, who's already beheaded his friend and fellow disciple James, Peter's able to sleep at peace the night before his trial. The fellow believers in Jerusalem are also trusting God's word. Jesus has invited us to pray in his word, and they're bringing Peter's needs to Jesus in prayer. This certainty and this peace that comes from God's word, that's yours too. Because God's word is certain and true, it continues to give us the peace we need and to also inspire us and empower us in the purpose that Jesus gives us to testify to his truth.
In our second lesson, we read, at about that time, King Herod laid violent hands on some who belonged to the church in order to mistreat them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with a sword. When he saw that this pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter during the days of unleavened bread. After arresting Peter, Herod put him in prison and handed him over to four squads of four soldiers, each to guard him. Herod intended to bring him before the people for trial after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church earnestly offered up prayer to God for him. The very night before Herod was going to bring him out for trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers. He was bound with two chains, while sentries were in front of the door guarding the prison. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord stood near him, and a light shone in his cell. The angel woke Peter up by striking him on the side, saying, "Quick, get up!" The chains fell from his wrists. Then the angel said to him, "Get dressed and put on your sandals." So he did so. Then the angel told him, "Put on your cloak and follow me." Peter went out following the angel, but he did not realize what the angel was doing. He was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. When they had passed through the first and second guard posts, they came to the iron gate that leads into the city. It opened all by itself for them. They went outside, walked down one street, and immediately the angel left him. When Peter came to himself, he said, "Now I know for sure that the Lord sent his angel and rescued me from the hand of Herod and from everything the Jewish people were expecting." When he realized this, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, who was also called Mark. Many had gathered there and were praying. When Peter knocked at the entrance gate, a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer. She recognized Peter's voice and was so overjoyed, she did not open the gate. Instead, she ran in and announced that Peter was standing in front of the gate. They told her, "You're out of your mind," but she kept on insisting it was so. And they started saying, "It's his angel." Meanwhile, Peter kept on knocking. When they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter motioned to them with his hand to be silent and described to them how the Lord had brought him out of prison. He said, "Tell these things to James and to the brothers." And he left and went on to another place. At daybreak, there was no small commotion among the soldiers about what had come of Peter. After Herod searched for him and did not find him, he questioned the guards and ordered that they be executed. This is our second lesson. Our verse of the day, alleluia, alleluia, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed, alleluia. Our hearts were burning with us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us, alleluia.
Seen and heard also to you, so that you may have fellowship with us.
Our fellowship is with the Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. We write these things to you so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we heard from him and proclaim to you. God is light, in him there is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him but still walk in darkness, we are lying and do not put the truth into practice. But if we walk in the light, just as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. My dear children, I write these things to you so that you will not sin. If anyone does sin, we have an advocate before the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the whole world. This is our distant lesson. Please stand. We confess our faith together now in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. We'll join in singing our sermon hymn in 145, stanzas 1 through 4. Thank you.
we focus our attention on is, again, our epistle lesson from 1 John chapter 1 and also the first few verses of chapter 2, found on page 7. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ,
so what questions were on your mind this past week? I guess there were a bunch of trivial questions. Tuesday morning, maybe you got up and said, Fruit Loops or Lucky Charms today? Or maybe on Thursday, you walked to your closet and said, do I wear my gray shirt or my red shirt with my slacks today? Or maybe, you know, it was 9 o'clock at night, you go to bed at 10:30, you said, I have an hour and a half, watch TV, read, what should I do? Were there some more important questions than those on your mind, though? Were there questions like, should I take this job or not? Should I move or not? Is this person I love going to be with me next week? Not. What's the doctor going to tell me on Friday? Maybe am I going to pay my bills this morning? In the past week, did you also mull over the most important questions? The German philosopher Immanuel Kant determined that there were three key questions that mankind needs to answer, that we all yearn for answers to. You want to know what they are? Number one, what can I know? What can I know with certainty in life? Number two, what should I do? In other words, how should I live my life? Number three, what may I hope? What can I realistically hope for and not be disappointed in life? It's interesting. I think that God actually agrees with Immanuel Kant that those are three fundamental questions everybody needs answered, because he addresses them and he answers them in this lesson. And he directs us to Jesus Christ, the risen Savior, for the answers to all those questions. Now, I know at this point you might be thinking, not that, I know that, I've been a Christian my whole life, so I'm not going to learn anything new today. And you're right, you won't. But here's why you still need to listen. You're going to get way too caught up in the questions that don't matter in the next week. You're going to agonize over questions that in the big picture aren't the important ones. They're going to cause you worry, they're going to cause you fear. And if those questions are not answered in the way you want them to be answered, you're going to be mad and frustrated, maybe even depressed. So let's go back to the real important questions. Let's look at the reliable answers we have to the questions that matter most. How reliable they are in the risen Savior for our comfort and our confidence, not only this next week, but for eternity. Let's get started. Question number one, what can I know? Man, I would be tempted to answer that question with a shrug of our shoulders and a who knows. Because I live in a world of fake news and alternative facts and people trying to get ahead of the story and people who want to form their own narrative, right? I live in a world where I end up saying, you know what? Everybody massages the truth, or let's face it, twists it into what they want you to believe. So, is there anything I can really know for sure? And then there's this notion that truth is always evolving. If you had a really bad migraine headache this next week and you went to the doctor, do you think he would bore a hole in your head? That's how doctors used to treat severe headaches. We don't do that anymore. We don't believe the world's flat anymore. We don't even believe that eggs are entirely bad for us anymore. Truth is evolving, right? Moral truth. Religious truth is also evolving, we're told. So what your grandparents believed about morality from the Bible, what they believed about faith from the Bible in their generation, may or may not be true today. In fact, maybe we hold what our grandparents believed, we'll be on the wrong side of history. So it might be easy for us to say, well, who knows what anybody can know. Except that John would put his hand up and say, hold on, back up a step here. Because actually, you can know with certainty the most important thing to know. And the most important thing to know is this. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have observed, and our hands have touched regarding the word of life. The life appeared and we have seen it. We testify and proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We are proclaiming what we have seen and heard also to you, so that you may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. So So John says, actually, you can know with certainty the most important thing to know, and that is who God is. God sent his Son to tell you who God is. That's why John calls him the Word. It's the last word about God. God tells you what he is and who he is through the life, the ministry, the work, the suffering, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. John tells us everything we need to know about God we see in Jesus. And when we see Jesus, we see a God who is holy, good, kind, compassionate, forgiving, merciful. And John tells us that this is the truth about God that gives us life. He calls Jesus the Word of life, because if there is one thing we do know in life, it's that all of us are going to die. That's a brutal truth. Everything you love on earth, everyone you love, you're going to be torn from when you die. But God loved you so much, he came to earth to rescue you from death and give you eternal life. That sounds like a fairy tale to me. That's what one guy told me one time. I can understand that. But that's exactly why John goes on to say, hang on a second. Prince Charming is not real. Jesus Christ, on the other hand, is real. John says, we heard his voice. We heard the voice of God. Like when on Easter evening, Jesus explained the scriptures to them, and it all made sense. That this was God's plan all along to send his Son, to reveal God to the world, to suffer and die for our sins, and free us from death. John says, we saw God when we saw Jesus. You think he's thinking of that day on the Mount of Transfiguration when they saw divine glory start to glow from Jesus? Or do you think he's talking about when he saw Jesus walking on the water? Or do you think he's thinking of when he saw people who were crippled suddenly jumping up and walking? Or people who were dead sitting up alive again at Jesus' command? Or do you think he was talking about the day he saw how much God loved him and he watched God die for him at the foot of the cross? John says, we touched him. The Greek word is, we physically examined him with our hands. That night the risen Savior appeared to Jesus, he invited them to do that. Go ahead and touch me. So the disciples came over and they grabbed that flesh, looked at the nail wounds, felt that it was warm, felt that Jesus was real, knew that Jesus was real. That their God had conquered death for them. John says that he testifies to what he heard and saw and touched so you can know what he knows. The Greek word testify, by the way, is martyrepo. It's the word from which we get our English word martyr. And John, in his mid-90s, has seen every one of the other apostles die as a martyr for the testimony of Jesus Christ. 12 guys don't die for what they know of the Bible. But you are willing to die for something you are convinced is the truth. There's a lot you and I don't know. And honestly, a lot of times what we don't know drives us crazy. I want to know. I love a crystal ball to see what's coming. So this week, when you start to get frustrated or upset or worried or afraid at what you don't know that you would like to know, take a step back and ask yourself, but do I know what I need to know? Do I know who God is? Do I know he loves me? Do I know he forgives me? Do I know he's going to take care of me until he takes me to heaven, all by his grace and my risen Savior? Because that's a God you can trust, a God you can love, and a God you can serve. Which, by the way, gets us to the answer to the second fundamental question. How should I live? I performed a wedding recently. You think I told the bride and groom on their wedding day, you're embarking on a new life now where you're no longer two but one, so I encourage you to live completely for yourself, each of you. That is a recipe for disaster in marriage. And it's also not what they wanted to hear. When you love someone, you say, I want to serve you. I'm going to stay faithful to you for my entire life. You know that the Bible calls your relationship with Jesus Christ kind of like a husband and wife relationship. You're that intimately connected to God through Christ. Paul says that in Ephesians chapter 5, the church we call the bride of Christ, the pictures in Revelation leading us to see ourselves as the bride of Christ. In that relationship, you know Jesus loves you and has served you and is still about serving you. So by faith, you love him and you want to serve him. And John says we do that when we walk in the light, even as God is in the light. the God in whom there is no darkness at all. So if you love Jesus, and I know you do, and you want to live to serve him, you walk in the light. You live a life that's enlightened by his commands. Except that John warns us, be careful. Don't claim you're walking in the light when you're intentionally taking a stroll in the darkness now and then. Because that means you're a hypocrite. That means you're a fake. Anybody here like hypocrites? Anybody here like fake people? God doesn't need them. But the thing to watch out for is this. Even while you might be flirting with hypocrisy and being a fake, claiming you walk in the light while you're strolling in the darkness a little bit, your sinful nature is never going to tell you that. Your sinful nature, in fact, is always going to tell you, you're not faking it. You're not a hypocrite. You're just indulging your natural desires a little bit. Everybody does it. And besides, you're not doing as much as the people you work with, and the people you go to school with, and the people in your neighborhood. You know that. You're overall still a much better person than them. This is not a big deal. Yes, it is, John says. If we say we have fellowship with him and still walk in darkness, we are lying and do not put the truth into practice. Now, it's bad enough to live a lie, but it's even worse when you're confronted with the fact that you're living a lie, to tell another lie and deny that you're actually living a lie. Right? So John condemns that too, saying, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Now, I know none of you are sitting here right now saying, I've never sinned. But on the other hand, let's understand that we have a sinful nature that, again, is never going to admit that what we are doing is sinful. And you've heard the arguments that come from your sinful nature, that what you're doing or how you're thinking or what you're believing is all wrong, right? The arguments go like this. Well, what God says in his word about what I'm doing isn't necessarily black and white, even though it's black and white. What God is saying here about what I'm doing is kind of a gray area. And we have a name for that gray area. It's called the open to interpretation gray area. Or your sinful nature may argue this. You're in special circumstances. And because you're in special circumstances, you have some fine print exemptions to what God's will is for you in this circumstance. Or your sinful nature argues, most of the world is doing the opposite of what God tells me to do. How can all of them be wrong? Or your sinful nature will argue, what God is asking me to do is just way too much. Or your sinful nature may argue, what I'm doing feels right to me, so if it feels right to me, it's got to be right to God because he's the one who created me. Isn't he the one who gave me the feelings I have? Self-deception is not only bad for you, it's really bad in your relationship with God. Because this is what you're really telling God. Paul says, if we say we have not sinned, we make God out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. Our refusal to acknowledge our sin for what it is calling the God who loved us and sent his son to die for us to give us life with him a liar. It's making a statement to all of the unbelievers out there in the world who are watching how we live, that even we Christians aren't necessarily certain that everything God tells us is true, that we can redefine it in our own hearts if we want. We're just making that statement to people who need to know and trust the truth that God came to be their Savior. And what's more, if we justify our sin away with our own reasoning, what if we need a Savior to take away our sin for them? Why do we believe in Jesus? And why bother to live a life for Jesus if in the end we can live as we please and justify it in our own minds and hearts? So to that second question, how should I live? I think it's clear how not to live. Don't live in the self-delusion of your own mind and heart, the kind that is to the harm of your soul and the degrading of God himself. Instead, step into the truth, to the light. And there in the light of God's word, you're going to see not only what God's clear will for you really is, but you're going to see his forgiving love for you in Christ. And there in that light, you don't have to pretend you're not sinning anymore or justify it. You can just admit the truth. Confident of his promise, we confess our sins
He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In fact, it's that promise of undeserved, merciful forgiveness that is what leads us to want to say, I want to walk in the light as he is in the light. It's the one thing that can overcome the selfishness and cowardice that keeps pulling us into the shadows. It's what you and I can help each other do. John reminds us that all together, confessing our sins and trusting in Jesus for forgiveness, we're in fellowship with one another. And that's important because I need you, and you need me, and we all need each other. Because it's not easy to follow Christ. It makes our lives harder. It doesn't make our lives easier. And we live in a world out there that's always pulling us the wrong direction. And our own hearts pull us in the wrong direction. We need brothers and sisters to honestly confront us when we're going the wrong way in love. To keep leading us back to Jesus. To keep assuring us of our forgiveness and encouraging us with them and with Christ to walk in love. We can encourage each other ultimately with that undeserved message of forgiveness and as a Savior. That's what leads us to answer that second question the right way. How should I live? To agree with John, my children, I write these things to you so that you will not sin. That leaves us with one more fundamental life question. What may I hope? I don't know. You can hope for a lot of things, right? You can hope that you make the soccer team. You can hope that the girl sitting two rows away from you likes you. You can hope that you pass your math test. You can hope that you get a job promotion. You can hope that you're going to like the new car you buy. You can hope that the weather's going to be nice next weekend when you're having a big family get-together. We can hope for all kinds of things. The problem is that our hopes are never guaranteed, are they? I don't know what the future is going to bring. And the reality is that I'm living in a world where hopes often get dashed, right? I'm living in a broken world because of sin. Because of that, a lot of times my hopes and my dreams get broken too. But not the one that matters. Not the hope that there's a God out there who loves me and forgives me and is going to take care of me until he brings me to heaven. The only thing that could wreck that hope is your sin. But what you did yesterday, that proves to God you're really not worthy of having a God like that. And the entire mountain of your sins, from the whole scope of your life, can't even put a little dent in that hope you have in Christ. And here's why not. Because of Christ himself. John assures us if anyone does sin, we have an advocate before the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the whole world. So when you come to God the Father, and you're standing in his presence, and you need help, direction, guidance, comfort, hope, strength, forgiveness, mercy you don't deserve, and you start to get a little nervous, you start to tremble because you know you really don't deserve any of that, here's the picture God sets up. Beside you is the most powerful and best attorney in the universe. He's your defense attorney, and he also happens to be your best friend who loves you more than anyone else, Jesus Christ. And he also happens to be the son of the judge, the Father. And when you're starting to tremble, he's your advocate. That means he's like the coach, confidant, defense attorney, puts his arm around you and whispers in your ear, don't worry, I've got this covered. I'm the righteous one. And when the Father thinks of you, he thinks of me because I came to live a completely righteous life in every way you have failed. And then I offered that life as payment for your sins on the cross. So nothing you have ever done is going to keep the Father from giving you exactly what you need today. Don't worry. Whatever you're seeking from the Father, he'll make sure you get exactly what you need at just the right time. And that's certain. Not because of me, but because of me. How awesome is that? How amazing is it to have that hope we need the most, certainly in Jesus Christ? So whatever questions are on your mind this next week, little ones or big ones, the bigger ones that can make you afraid or worried, Take a step back and remember that you have solid, reliable answers to the most important questions.
And they're reliable because you have a reliable, risen Savior in whom you find the answers to those questions. And because you do, live confidently in your faith in Him. And live confidently in your life. Amen. You may remain seated.
The peace of God, which transcends understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We'll continue with the gathering of our thank offerings at this time. Please also sign our friendship bracelets.
Assure them of your abiding presence and comfort them with the hope of eternal life. We remember in our prayers today Erica Gunthorpe, who will be undergoing surgery this week. Jessica Bursley and Ron Heine, who are recovering from surgery. Carol McBride and Sue Spencer, the sisters of Mary Goldner, Lois Healy, Kathy Kinney, Randy Linton, and Dave Ross, all of whom are experiencing ill health or health struggles. We ask that you would provide all that they need for body and soul in your mercy and grace. Give them confidence that you are always with them and that your promises are true forever. And now hear us, Lord, as we also bring you our private petitions. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, as we also pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Thank you.
having the memorial service for Cheryl Estes at 12:30 today here in the sanctuary. So our parent discussion scheduled for today has been postponed. Also take note that there will be no refreshments after the service today as well, because the kitchen area is being used for the luncheon that will follow that memorial service. Voters, take note that there will be a voters meeting next Sunday, April 29th, following the late service. The agenda for that meeting is on the bulletin board near the photo posters. I'll let everybody know too that we received good news this week that the company that is installing the new camera and some other audio visual upgrades for our sanctuary, especially for recording the worship service, and also a loop system for the hearing impaired, that installation will take place a week from tomorrow. Hopefully it's a one-day job, so that in 2 weeks from today, we'll have all of that up and functioning, which will be a blessing to us in a number of ways. So, thankful for that. The summer cleaning schedule for Michigan State Campus Ministry is out on the bulletin board, and you can sign up if you want to help out our local campus ministry by cleaning their chapel. It's two stories, a smaller sanctuary, and a couple of offices on the first floor, and then a basement area, a little kitchen and a little fellowship area. If we have enough people sign up to do that, maybe you do it once every couple of months, every 3 months, and many hands make my work. So if you can help with that, please sign up to help with that today. I simply want to call your attention, as well as we wrap up, to this little one sheet page. I put it in everybody's literature boxes. It kind of is a synopsis of the presentation we gave about a month ago about our facility expansion plans and also the support for that. So just know that this will be helpful to you to not only get a look at what we're looking at building, but also to look at the funding plan for that. According to our long-range plan, we'd like to start construction in 4 years. And given the fact that we have $300,000 the Lord has blessed us with toward the down payment of $800,000, we're looking at about $500,000 for the next 4 years that would enable us to start on 2022. I want to highlight again that if you take a conservative figure of 160 members and $125,000 a year for the next 4 years to reach that $500,000 mark, that's achievable. That's about a little over $2 a day or $15 a week. However, all that does is demonstrate that this is actually achievable. Your church council doesn't want to send a message, so everybody give this much and we'll be able to do it. That's between you and God, and actually what we do want to encourage you to do is to give the way God encourages us to give, proportionately and generously. In the Old Testament, that was a tithe, 10% of income, and we're going to simply encourage you, if you can see the blessings of this, to look at 6% of your income. This is an encouragement. And this 6% would enable us not only to achieve our regular budget, but also to achieve our goal for the down payment. That is the biblical way to encourage God's people to give and thanks to the Lord. This might help you stretch a little bit in your giving. And it would also help us to get that goal or hit that target of what we're looking at for the down payment. So just consider that, and if you have any questions about the project or the plan, by all means talk to your leaders, including your pastors or church council members, about that. Any other final announcements today? If not, thank you, and may the Lord bless your people with his grace.